In this video, we are going to learn how to read ECG in 11th step. This will be a simplified video as compared to my previous video on ECG. So whenever you get an investigation, always you need to do some basic things, that is check name and date of the patient. The second thing is calibration. For calibration in ECG, normally ECG is taken at 25 millimeters per second. That is the speed at, of the roll of the ECG is 25 millimeters per second. And each big square corresponds to 0.2 seconds and each small square corresponds to 0.04 seconds. So if you know these basic things about ECG, you can actually read the ECG. So basically the 11th step which we are going to follow in this is that first find out the rhythm, whether it is regular, irregular, rate of the ECG, axis of the ECG, then coming to individual waves, that is P wave, PR interval, QRS complex, Q wave, R wave, S wave, ST segment, and then the T wave. So in this basic steps, we are going to learn how to read an ECG. So rhythm. Now rhythm like pulse rate can be regular or irregular. What a regular rhythm means is that the interval between these two, the R waves, is constant. It is the RR interval, that is the RR interval is constant. If the RR interval was varying, it is called as irregular rhythm. Now there is something called as sinus rhythm. Sinus rhythm means if the pacemaker is SA node, if SA node is the pacemaker, the rhythm is sinus rhythm. So when SA node is the pacemaker, there is a P wave followed by a PR interval, then Q wave, R wave, S wave, and the T wave. That is P followed by Q, R, S followed by T. So if this sequence is maintained, then it is called as sinus rhythm. Another thing for sinus rhythm is that the PR interval, that is the distance from the beginning of P to the beginning of R, should be constant. So what a sinus rhythm means that all P waves are followed by QRS followed by T, and the PR interval is constant. This is sinus rhythm. And the RR interval, if it is constant, it means a regular. The rhythm is regular. So if it is not constant, then it is irregular rhythm. Now second step is the rate. Now normally we know that our normal pulse rate is 60 to 100 beats per minute. So how do you calculate rate on ECG? So on ECG, the rate can be calculated as 300 divided by number of large boxes between the two R waves. So if you consider these two R waves, the number of large boxes is 1, 2, 3. So this is half, so we consider 4. So the rate will be 300 by 4. So it will be around 75 beats per minute in this ECG. There is another easier method, that is in the ECG, look for any QRS complex which is coinciding with the dark line. So if you see this QRS complex, this is coinciding with the dark line. So if the next QRS complex comes on this dark line, the rate is 300. If the next QRS complex comes on this line, the rate is 150. If it comes on the next dark line, the rate is 100. If it comes on this dark line, the rate is 75. If it comes on this, it is 60 50. So on this ECG, you can directly say that it is not 300, it is not 150, it is not 100, it is nearly 75. It is more than 75, more than 70. You can actually say on this ECG, this is a rough thing. So we know that tachycardia is rate more than 100, bradycardia is rate less than 60 beats per minute. Now coming to axis. So normal axis we need to remember is minus 30 degrees to plus 110 degrees. To see axis, the first method to see axis is see lead 1 and AVL. So what you have to do is that you have to plot this. So this is positive lead 1, this is negative lead 1. Sorry, this is AVF. And then you consider AVF. So positive AVF and negative AVF. So now this is lead 1, this is AVF. So if you see the QRS complex in the lead 1, here it is plus 1 and the negative deflection is about 5, about 10, and minus 10. So the net result is minus 9. So I'll plot this lead one on negative side of minus 9. Then we'll see the AVF. AVF QRS, if you see, is about plus 6 and about minus 2. So it is plus 4. So I'll plot it on this direction. So if you see this, the axis is in this direction. So normal axis will be around this much. So minus 30 to plus 110. So if the axis is deviated on the right side of AVF, it is called as right axis deviation. If it is deviated on the left side, it is called as left axis deviation. If it is extremely deviated on the right side, if the axis comes here, it is called as extreme right axis deviation. So if it is deviated on the right side of AVF, on the right side of the maximum normal axis, it is called right axis. If it is deviated on the left side, it is called as left axis. If extremely deviated, then it is called as extreme right axis deviation. So this is a bit complicated method. There is another method which you can use, is that you see lead 1 and lead 3. So one mnemonic you need to remember is that left leaves and right reaches. That is, in left axis deviation, it is left leaves, and in right axis deviation, right reaches. So what you see is that you see the QRS complex in lead 1, you see the QRS complex in lead 3. So if you plot it like this, the lead 1 is like this and lead 3 is predominantly like this. So if the tip of QRS complex is leaving each other in left axis deviation. If you see in right axis deviation, if you see this ECG here, you can see that lead 1 is negative, lead 3 is predominantly positive. So these two are reaching each other. So in right axis deviation, the QRS complex reach each other in lead 1 and 3. In left axis deviation, the QRS complex leave each other in lead 1 and 3. So this is a simple method to remember which is the direction of the axis. That is, you will not get the exact degree of axis, but you can roughly estimate whether there is left axis deviation or right axis deviation. Now, after this rhythm, rate and axis, the next step is to look for P waves. So normal P waves, you need to remember, is that the normal is 2 into 2. That is, the height as well as width of P wave is 2 into 2 small boxes. Two small boxes up, two small boxes is the width. If the height is increased without increase in width, if the height is increased without increase in width, it is called as tall tented P wave, which indicates right atrial enlargement. If the height is increased along with the width, the P wave will be like a M, that is bifid P wave. It is due to left atrial enlargement. Only this much you have to remember, that normal P wave is 2 into 2. If it is taller than 2, but not two small boxes, but the width is normal, it indicates that it is due to right atrial enlargement. If the P wave is broader, the width is increased as well as the height is increased, it indicates left atrial enlargement. Now the next step is calculate PR interval. PR interval is from the beginning of the P wave to beginning of the QRS. So normally it is 3 to 5 small squares, 3 to 5 small squares, that is 120 to 200 milliseconds. Now if the PR, what PR interval indicates is that it indicates AV nodal delay. So any prolongation in PR interval, that is increase in PR interval, increase PR interval indicates that there is AV block, AV nodal block. AV nodal block. So it could be first degree heart block where there is only prolongation of PR interval, or it could be second degree where there is prolongation of PR interval along with some drop beats, or third degree where there is no conduction of the beat from the SA node to the ventricle. As a result, there is atria via beating at its own rate and ventricles are beating at its own rate. That is AV dissociation, that is complete heart block. Now, if there is short PR interval, means it is less than 3 small boxes. It indicates that the conduction is not going through AV node, because PR interval indicates AV nodal delay. So if the PR was short, that is directly the P wave is ending into QRS complex, that means there is an accessory pathway. It is seen in Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. So if there is prolongation of PR interval, it indicates there is AV nodal block. If the PR interval is short, it means there is accessory pathway. Now coming to QRS complex, the normal QRS complex width is less than 3 small boxes, that is less than 120 milliseconds. If the PR interval, if the QRS is broad, that is, if it is more than 3 small boxes, it is called as broad or wide QRS. When there is wide QRS, it could be of two types, that is LBBB morphology, that is left bundle branch morphology, or RBBB morphology. So these two morphologies can be identified by just remembering the word William and Marrow. So you have to write V1 here, V6 here, V1 here, V6 here. So William, the L indicates LBBB. In LBBB, you get W in V1 and M in V6. Okay, in RBBB, that is R of Marrow, in V1 you get M pattern in V1 and W pattern in V6. Along with this, you will get the same thing, that is left leaves and right reaches. So when you see lead 1 and lead 3, you will, in right axis, in RBBB, you will see that the QRS complex of lead 1 and lead 3 are reaching towards each other. In LBBB, they are leaving each other. So by this, based on QRS complex, whether it is normal, that is less than 3 small boxes, if it is broad, you have to determine the morphology, that is LBBB type or RBBB type. If LBBB type, you will get W in V1 and M in V6. If it is RBBB type, you will get M in V1 and W in V6. Now next wave is Q wave. Q wave is the first negative deflection in the QRS complex, which is preceding the R wave. So normal normal Q wave is less than 1 small square wide and less than 2 small square deep. If it is more than 25% of the R wave, if the negative deflection is more than 25% of the R wave, it is called as pathological Q wave. A pathological Q wave indicates past myocardial infarction. However, it can be also seen in conditions such as pulmonary embolism, but it is commonly due to myocardial infarction. Now coming to R wave. So R wave is the only positive deflection of QRS complex. Now whenever you want to comment about the morphology of R wave or S wave, you have to see three main leads, that is V1, V2 and V3. So normally what happens, the R wave height goes on increasing as you see the chest leads from V1 to V6. If you see the S wave is increasing progressively, this is called as R wave progression. This is R wave progression. Now, based on the R wave, various pathologies can be determined. If the R wave height is equal to or more than S wave in V1, if the R wave height, R wave is equal to S wave or R wave is greater than S wave in V1, indicates right ventricular hypertrophy. It is commonly associated with T inversion in V1. If the T inversion is not present, but that is R wave is greater than S wave, it might indicate posterior wall myocardial infarction. Now the next wave in the ECG is S wave. For S wave, again we have to see V1 to V3. Normally what happens, the S wave, depth of S wave from V1 to V6 normally reduces. If it is not reducing, it may be because of pathology. So if you find the deepest S wave in V1, V2, V1 or V2 is greater than four large boxes, then you add it to the R wave in V5 or V6. If the total is more than 7, it indicates left ventricular hypertrophy. This is the voltage criteria. This can be simply written as S in V1 or V2 plus R in V5 or V6. If it is more than 35, indicates left ventricular hypertrophy. That is, more than 35 small boxes means left ventricular hypertrophy. Now coming to most important part of ECG, that is ST segment. So what is the ST segment? ST segment is at the end of S to the beginning of T, whatever segment is there, that is ST segment. So to what we compare ST segment? Whenever we have to compare whether ST segment is normal or elevated or depressed, we have to compare it with the segment between P and Q. This segment, we have to compare it with this segment. Now, if I draw this continuously here, it will be in this direction. So in this ECG, this is the P wave, PR, Q wave, R wave, then the S wave. Then if you see the ST segment from here to here, if you mark, it is elevated above the baseline. Elevation above the baseline by 1 millimeter is present. That means there is ST elevation is present. Okay. If it is from the baseline, if it is depressed, if you see this is the baseline, it is depressed here. ST segment is depressed. It is called as ST depression. So if it is elevated from the baseline, it is called as ST elevation. If it is depressed from the baseline, it is called as ST depression. So causes of ST elevation are acute myocardial infarction, acute pericarditis, LV aneurysm. Now between these two, acute myocardial infarction and acute pericarditis, normally if you see the ST segment from above, it is concave. Normal ST segment from above, if you see, it is concave. If the concavity of the ST segment is lost and the ST is elevated, it indicates it is myocardial infarction. The loss of concavity of the ST segment with ST elevation is acute myocardial infarction. If the concavity is not lost but the ST elevation is present, it indicates it is acute pericarditis. Acute pericarditis, another sign of acute pericarditis is PR depression. PR depression along with ST elevation, which is concave upwards, is acute pericarditis. Now, ST depression is a sign of acute ischemia. That is, if you see sub-endocardial infarction, that is non-ST elevation myocardial infarction or unstable angina, you get something called as ST depression, where ST is depressed below the baseline. Now, last step is T wave. Normal T wave should be in the same direction. If you see here, normal T wave is in the same direction as the QRS complex. If it is inverted, then if this becomes like this, it indicates there is ischemia. Also, in old infarct, there is T wave inversion. Now, tall T wave could be because of hyperkalemia or hyperacute MI. In hyperkalemia, the T wave is just tall, but the width is normal. If the width is also increased along with the tall T wave, it indicates hyperacute T wave, that is in hyperacute myocardial infarction. That is, broad and tall T wave is hyperacute MI. Only tall T wave with narrow base is hyperkalemia. So based with this, our 11 steps are complete. So now we will quickly revise all the 11 steps. So in this ECG, the first step, what we said is first see the rhythm. So rhythm, what we have to do is plot the two difference between the RR interval. If you see these two RR, it is same. So it is regular. Rhythm is regular. The next thing is we have to calculate the rate. So rate, what we said is 300 divided by large boxes. So large boxes, if I calculate here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 large boxes. So my rate would be 300 divided by 5. So 5, 6 is 30. So rate is 60 beats per minute. Okay. Next thing is axis. Axis, what I said is that you see lead one, you see AVF. So lead one is 1, 2, 3 positive, 1, 2, 2 negative. So it is positive lead one, negative lead one, AVF, positive AVF, negative AVF. So it is 1, 3 positive, 2 negative. So it is 1 plus 1 here. And AVF, if I see, is almost 5 positive, 1 negative. So it is 4 positive. So axis is normal axis. So around axis is around plus 30 degrees. So axis plus 30 to plus 40 degrees. And after this, we comment on the P wave. So if you see P wave here, P wave is about two small boxes and height is about one small boxes. So P wave is normal P wave, and PR interval. Now PR interval, if you see from beginning of P to the beginning of QRS complex, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So PR interval is about 200, that is 5 small boxes, which is normal. Now PR, after PR interval, we will comment on the Q wave. So if you see lead 1, there are no Q waves. If you see lead 2, no Q waves. Here if you see, there is one small Q wave. However, the significant Q wave, what I said is that more than 25% of the R wave. So this is not more than 25%, so it is not significant. Now AVR, if you remember, AVR is always negative. So we cannot comment upon QRS in AVR. Basically Q in AVR. In lead AVL, if you see, there are no Q waves. In AVF, there are small insignificant. In rest of the ECGs, there are no Q waves. So basically there are no pathological Q waves in this ECG. Next, coming to R wave. R wave, what I said is that we see V1, V2, V3. So if you see V1, there is very small R wave. V2, the R wave is increasing. V3, it is increasing. V4, V5, V6, it is increasing. So there is normal progression of R wave. There is no R wave abnormality. Now coming to S wave. Now S wave is also normally increasing. It is not, if you see V1, V2, it is not more than 4 large boxes. So we need not think of left ventricular hypertrophy in this ECG. So S wave is normal. Now complete QRS. If you see QRS altogether, it is less than 3 small boxes. So QRS is also normal. Now coming to ST segments. So ST segment in lead 1, if you see lead 1, if you plot PR, there is slight ST depression. ST depression in lead 1. Now, whenever you read any ECG, you have to divide the leads into, first thing is lateral leads, inferior leads, anterior leads. So lateral leads are lead 1, AVL, V5, V6. Inferior leads are 2, 3, AVF. Now anterior leads are V3, V4, septal or V1, V2. So whenever I read any lead, I'll see these leads together. So lead 1, AVL and V5, V6 I'll see. So if you see in lead 1 and AVL, there is ST depression, but V5, V6 are normal. Then I'll see inferior leads. If you see the lead 2, 3 as well as AVF, if you plot, this is the J point, this is the baseline. So if you see, there is ST segment. ST segment is very much elevated, as well as if you see the T wave is tall and broad. So what we can see is that inferior leads are showing ST elevation with hyperacute T's. ST elevation in inferior leads, if the lateral leads are showing ST depression, that is reciprocal changes which are present in the lateral leads. Also, if you see V1, V2, V3 also is showing ST depression. ST depression in presence of inferior wall MI is an indicator of posterior wall MI also. So in this ECG, there is inferior plus posterior wall ST elevation MI. Okay, so our complete diagnosis would be inferior plus posterior wall MI. So with this, today's video is complete. If you like my video, kindly like, share and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.